to say evening prayer, because by the time I post this, it'll probably be evening. And I'm going to say the office of readings. There's an office of readings from Apostle Paul and Saint Cyprian. I hope you enjoy this, and if you have this book, you can follow along, but I will pray for us and with you. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, the antiphon is, come, daughters, draw close to the Lord and share the splendor. lamps alight. Keep the vitality of your consecrated handmaids burning brightly. Lord, your virgin church has always kept its faith whole and untarnished. Grant all Christians a whole and untarnished faith. You have given your people joy in celebrating the feast of your Holy Virgin. Give us constant joy through her intercession. You have admitted the Holy Virgins to your marriage banquet. In your mercy, lead the dead to your heavenly feast. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Lord, you have told us that you live forever in the hearts of the chaste. By the prayers of the Virgin, help us to live by your grace, and remember a temple of your Spirit. Grant that through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Mary, ever Virgin, pray for us.
Sharp people will fall beneath you. The foes of the king fall down.
Jesus Christ. Listen, O daughter, give ear to my words. Forget your own people and your father's house, so the king will desire your beauty. He is your lord. Pay homage to him. As the people of Tyre shall come with gifts, the richest of people shall seek your favor. The daughter of the king is clothed in splendor, her robes embroidered with pearls set in gold. She is led to the king with her maiden companions. They are escorted amid gladness and joy. They pass within the palace of the king. Sons shall be yours in place of your fathers. You will make them princes over all the earth. May this song make your name forever remembered. May the peoples praise you from age to age. Antiphon, the king, has desired your beauty. He is your lord and god. You have shown me how to live. You will fill me with joy in your presence. The first reading from the first letter of the Apostle Paul to the Corinthians. With respect to virgins, I have not received any commandment from the Lord, but I give my opinion as one who is trustworthy, thanks to the Lord's mercy. It is this: in the present time of stress, it seems good to me for a person to continue as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Then do not seek your freedom. Are you free of a wife? If so, do not go in search of one. Should you marry, however, you will not be committing sin. Neither does a virgin commit a sin if she marries. But such people will have trials in this life, and to these I should like to spare you. I tell you, brothers, the time is short. From now on, those with wives should live as though they had none. Those who weep should live as though they were not weeping, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing. Buyers should conduct themselves as though they owned nothing, and those who make use of the world as though they were not using it. For the world as we know it is passing away. I should like you to be free of all worries. The unmarried man is busy with the Lord's affairs, concerned with pleasing the Lord. But the married man is busy with this world's demands and occupied with pleasing his wife. This means he is divided. The virgin, indeed, any unmarried woman, is concerned with things of the Lord in pursuit of holiness in body and spirit. The married woman, on the other hand, has the cares of the world to absorb her and is concerned with pleasing her husband. I am going into this with you for your own good. I have no desire to place restrictions on you, but I do want to promote what is good and what will help you to devote yourselves entirely to the Lord. If anyone thinks he's behaving dishonorably towards his virgin, because a critical moment has come and it seems that something should be done, let him do as he wishes. He commits no sin if there is a marriage. The man, however, who stands firm in his resolve, who, while without constraint and free to carry out his will, makes up his mind to keep his virgin, also acts rightly. To sum up, the man who marries his virgin acts fittingly. The one who does not will do better. A wife is bound to her husband as long as he lives. If her husband dies, she is free to marry, but on one condition, that it be in the Lord. She will be happier, but on one condition, that it be in the Lord. She will be happier, though, in my opinion, if she stays unmarried. I am persuaded that in this I have the Spirit of God. The king has desired your beauty, which he himself has given you. Your God and king has become your spouse. He has provided for you and adorned you. He has redeemed you and made you holy. Now you are wedded to your king and your God. Your God and king have become your spouse. The second reading, a sermon on the dress of their way of life is more exalted, our concern for them must be greater. If we compare the church to a tree, then they are its blossom. Virgins show forth the beauty of God's grace. They are the image of God that reflects the holiness of the Lord. They are the most illustrious members of Christ's flock. They are the glory of Mother Church and the manifest, and they manifest her fruitfulness. The more numerous her virgins are, the greater her joy. To these virgins then I speak and address my exhortation out of love rather than any sense of authority, and I do this without claiming the right to censure them, for I am among the last and the least and fully aware of my loneliness. I do it rather because the more anxious and concerned I am for them, the more I fear the devil's attack, for it is no idle concern nor vain fear that takes thought of the path of salvation and keeps the Lord's life-giving commandments. They have dedicated themselves to Christ, and renouncing the pleasures of the flesh, have consecrated themselves body and soul to God in order to finish a task that is destined to win a great prize. They should not strive to adorn themselves or give pleasure to anyone but the Lord, for whom they hope to receive the reward for their chastity. Virgins, preserve in the way of life you have begun. Persevere in what you are to be, for you will receive a glorious prize for your virtue, a most excellent reward for your chastity. You have already begun to be now what we shall be in the future. You already possess here in this world the glory of the resurrection. You pass through this world without the world's infection. If you persevere in chastity and virginity, you are equal to God's angels. Only keep your profession of virginity strong and inviolate. You began your way of life courageously. Now persevere without faltering. Seek right conduct as your adornment, not jewelry or attractive clothing. Listen to the voice of the Apostle Paul, God's chosen vessel, sent to announce the commands of heaven. Paul said, "The first man was made of the dust of the earth. The second is from heaven. Those who are made from the earth are like him who was on the earth. Those who are of heaven are like him who is from heaven. As we have borne the image of the man who is of the earth, so let us bear the image of the man who is in heaven. This image is shown forth in virginity, purity, holiness, and truth. The thoughts of the virgin are always upon God. Her desire is to be holy in both body and soul. The God of my heart is my portion forever. Her desire is to be holy both in body and soul." I'm going to read this decree on the renewal of religious life of the Second Vatican Council in honor of you, especially if you are a religious. And thank you, by the way, for all your prayers for the world, for me, for the Holy Church. God bless you. The Church follows Christ, its only spouse. From the beginning of the Church, there have been men and women who sought to follow Christ with greater freedom and to imitate him with closer fidelity. Through the practice of the evangelical councils, they have led lives dedicated to God, each in his or her own way. Many of them, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, have lived in solitude or have founded religious communities, which the Church willingly recognized and approved by its authority. As a result, in accordance with God's plan, there has grown up a wonderful multifaceted wisdoms of God. Surrounded by this rich profusion of gifts, all who are called by God to the practice of the evangelical counsels and profess them with fidelity dedicate themselves to the Lord in a special way. They follow Christ, who in virginity and poverty redeemed and sanctified mankind through obedience, even to death upon a cross. Driven thus by the love of the Holy Spirit pours into their hearts, they live more and more for Christ and for his body, which is the church. The more fervent their union with Christ through this gift of self throughout their lives, the richer is the life of the church, and the more vigorous and fruitful its apostolate. The members of each institute should remember above all that in professing the evangelical counsels, they have given their response to the call of God in such a way that they are to live for God alone, not only by dying to sin, but also by renouncing the world. They have surrendered to his service the whole of their lives. This constitutes a special consecration, deeply rooted in the consecration of baptism, to which it gives fuller expression. Those who profess the evangelical counsels should seek and love above all things the God who has first loved us. In every circumstance of life, they should strive to foster a life hidden with Christ and God. Such a life is a source of and a stimulus to the love of one's neighbor for the salvation of the world and the building up of the church. This love is the animating and guiding principle for the practice of the evangelical.